By the way, this story isn't a big perv thing.
Get to the sex.
All right, you primitive screwheads, listen up.
Roger, roger. What's our vector, Victor?
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass.
I know that, Mr. Man. They also call them cereals. I'm not stupid, you know.
The story is ludicrous. You can imagine where it goes from here.
Fixes the cable.
In the 1970s, there was Clockwork Orange. Then in the 1980s came Mad Max. Now comes a startling new vision that takes you into the apocalypse and beyond. Back to the old drive-in you used to know and love. Only now, when the show is over, there is no way out. Welcome to your future, like it or not. Dead End Drive-In.
Hurry up, Dylan, where are you? Come on, we gotta get a show started
okay.
Here.
The sun has gone down. The customers have been removed from the shop, which means this is Black Dog After Dark. I am Dylan Reimer, a regular employee of Black Dog Videos. To my left is...
I'm Alex Chisholm. I'm also a employee of Black Dog Video and a programmer at the Rio Theater.
I'm Darren Gay. I own this swanky establishment.
Swank.
Yes, it's swank. And I guess we'd have to say this is a special edition of the podcast because we're doing a movie that nobody's seen before.
I had seen it.
Did you see it?
Yeah.
Oh, never mind. Scratch that.
There's a reason I got so excited. But let's fill people in. We are doing a 1986 Ozploitation film, Dead End Drive-In.
Mm-hmm.
But this is pretty much as cult as any film I'm aware of anyway.
Yeah.
Directed by Brian Trenchard Smith.
Trenchard. His middle name is Trenchard.
Trenchard. Known for Leprechaun 3 and Leprechaun 4. That's the one where the leprechaun is in space.
So he's known for that.
Have you guys seen it?
Yeah. Well, no, I've never seen any of the Leprechaun movies.
Turkey Shoot and Stunt Rock, which we...
He did Stunt Rock.
Yeah, he did Stunt Rock.
Ah, Stunt Rock. So I kicked myself out of a movie theater that was showing Stunt Rock.
Why?
Well, I was quite drunk. It was a midnight showing at the Cinemarte Film Festival, and I was with my friend. And I thought it'd be a great movie to sort of heckle and enjoy along with the film.
Yeah.
But no one else in the theater thought that.
I was at the screening you got kicked out of, and I didn't
get kicked out. I kicked myself out. I removed myself.
Or you left. Probably Cinemorte, you know, but I saw it there, and I love that movie.
Okay, were you guys even aware of this movie?
Yeah, I've known about this title for years. I knew nothing about the movie. I always assumed, I heard about it in the 80s, in that whole video boom era, you know, exploitation. And I've always been under the assumption that this was some kind of slasher movie. I was way
off. Same here. I thought it was a
horror
movie.
I always thought it was a slasher movie set, but I'm aware of the title for years.
Well, if you look at the cover, it looks like a horror movie.
Yeah.
I was a little disappointed it wasn't a horror movie, actually.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
This movie used to be on, and I know I say this all the time, but this is one of those KVOS TV-12 in the 80s, come home, I'm like really, really high. Mm. And this movie just always seemed to be on TV. And to the point where you never even watched it. It was like Hell Comes to Frogtown. It was one of these memorable titles.
That I've never seen.
I don't even really remember it because it's a headier film than I liked when I was 13 watching this. I remember thinking it was pretty boring and they're all just stuck in this drive-in. Back in the 80s.
I guess we can move on past yes. Our first memories of the film.
Well, I know.
So we have no memories of the film. My first memory of the film was 2 nights ago.
Was me being very excited when I found it because some weirdo came in and sold it.
Very excited when we picked it up, for sure.
Yeah, man. Is there a plot?
Yeah, kind of. It's like it's set in some weird post-apocalyptic future in Australia. It was a pretty tame post-apocalyptic future. There's a few fires around and... Some mm-hmm. punks drive around in cars and stuff like that. And
it doesn't take a lot for martial law to be instituted because they have that scroll at the beginning where they said there were some kind of like riots.
Oh, yeah.
There's something called the White Massacre.
They give several different historical dates in the beginning, like in this almost a prologue without words. They just print it on screen how society has fallen kind of from.
Right.
But it's one of the many million Mad Max ripoffs of the
80s. Yeah.
That particular element reminded me of Escape from New York.
Oh, it was very Escape from New York, too. And, of course, Escape from New York, as brilliant and original as it is also very Mad Max influenced.
Which was?
Mad Max was definitely before.
Oh, so Mad Max.
It was like 78 or 79 or something like that, Mad Max, the first one, right?
Exactly. But there was a lot of that dystopian post-apocalyptic stuff going on in the 80s with all that Cold War fear going on and stuff.
And for some reason, in all those movies, everyone's like a punk rocker.
This is, what, 86?
I think it's moving
from punk into the new wave.
Yeah.
Basically, this movie, it's like Mad Max meets Pretty in Pink or something, or Night of the Comet.
Yeah, kind of. That's a movie I like to watch again. I just don't remember much about that. I really like that movie.
It might be a good pairing for this one, actually, Night of the Comet. Like, some of these characters, the big pink hair and all of it. And they're supposed to be tough, and you're just kind of laughing at them because,
Well, that's how I felt about the hero. I just couldn't take him seriously at all. The lead guy,
whatever his name is,
he totally reminded me nonstop.
Krabs. That's right, Krabs.
Like, as in pubic lice.
Yeah. All I thought of the whole time while watching the movie, it was like a Lamal music video. Lamal was the lead singer of Kaja Goo Goo. Remember that song? Shy, shy to I. He went solo as Lamal and sang the theme song to The Neverending Story.
I remember it.
So this
guy
looked, this dude looked just like Lamal, the star of this.
You're telling me the person
movie.
Who sang Never Ending Store, that was a dude?
Yeah.
My entire
Who
life.
Who also sang
My
Too Shy Shy
life.
Hush
it's
Hush
been,
I to
been
I.
upended now.
But I kept
Every podcast you crank out some deep cut 80s fucking track that no one's ever heard of. That's why we love you, man.
That's why we keep him around.
I'm not shitting on you, man. I'm not shitting on you. I'm saying like... It's a badly needed element.
It's impressive. The and wealth of useless knowledge that you have stored in that cranium of yours is impressive, my
Cliff
friend.
Cliff Clavin, ladies and gentlemen. But
you should go on Jeopardy.
What was a shy. I mean, what was that song you just quoted?
Too shy, shy, hush, hush, I to Y.
I'd...
Nick Rhodes from Duran Duran.
How do you remember that?
It was a huge
hit. I've already
forgotten.
He just told me it.
It was a massive hit in the 80s.
Like the Purple People Eater.
One thing I noticed in this movie, in the post-apocalyptic future, that video stores still exist.
Well, that's good.
Yeah, there's a video store on one of the smoky streets they're driving. I'm good. There's one of the smoky streets that they're driving around on.
Well, because they filmed it on Commercial Drive. So Commercial Drive, look today with all the fog, very smoky.
Yeah, and there's still a video store here.
Yes, there is.
So he's it starts out when you first see Krabs. Or I don't know what his actual name is, but he calls himself Krabs.
Why would you call yourself Krabs? Because he had crabs once.
He thought he had crabs once. Because he gets cornered by the Get Along Gang. This gang, they look like the New York Dolls or something. They're really hard to take seriously as tough guys.
Very hard to take. They're not tough guys at all.
Yeah, but like by the end of it, they're supposed to be taken seriously as tough guys because they get all racist. There's that weird racism subplot.
Yeah, all of a sudden, because that came out of nowhere. We'll get to that anyways. Yeah.
So he's jogging. So Krabs is going for a midnight run through Nightmare Australia.
Yeah. It's like cans of fire. It's always the post-apocalyptic world always has big cans on fire, like the drums that are on fire for some reason.
And he runs by. He antagonizes a German Shepherd. He
calls the dog useless.
Everyone's mean to this dog. In the opening credit sequence with this awesome fucking like 80s soundtrack to this thing is like an imitation of 80s inspiration rock.
Right.
You know,
lots of synthesizers and fake drums and all that kind of crap.
And all that good stuff. And he's running by, and he treats the dog like shit. And then some gang comes by, the Carboys, I think they're called.
Yeah.
The Carboys.
Who go around taking parts off cars or something. That's their shtick. Because, then he goes off with his brother, who is like a tow truck driver guy.
Well, first they try and roll him for his shoes.
Oh, right. They want his shoes.
Because he's going to visit his girlfriend or whatever. And it's just three young women standing on the corner. The society falling down thing doesn't quite... cut the mustard, because there's no way three teenage girls can be standing around waiting to get raped.
I thought it was a really tame post-apocalyptic future. It was pretty mild, you know.
Compared to Mad Max, it didn't.
Yeah, well, I think budget restrictions. You know, they had budgets for putting some cans on fire, and that was about it. And having some paper blow down the street. Yeah, I don't think it. Yeah, it's probably pretty minuscule. I have to guess.
None of this goes anywhere. It's almost pointless even talking about it on this show. But the Carboys, they're like, "I want your shoes, Norse trainers, or whatever." And then, I guess they get chased away by the police or some shit.
Yeah.
All of this, by the way, the angry dog, the paper everywhere. The
useless dog. Kelsey, why would you call a dog useless? How is a dog useless?
I don't know. Dogs seem
maybe
useful.
It's his name. What's useless here, useless.
What's it supposed to do?
It wasn't meant as a put down. It's his name.
It was barking
it's
at people.
It's that accent. He's saying Ulysses. It's not a Ulysses.
Ulysses.
Yeah, it's not useless at all.
You're Ulysses.
That's his dog. The movie, because it has even this element that reminds me of a movie, a recent film that I really loved, which is Nightcrawler.
Yeah.
The greedy crew showing up to film a nasty car accident. Yeah. I loved the two. By the way, when the movie started, I was like, I'm going to absolutely love this. Mm-hmm. Coming off the opening credits, I'm like, I'm going to totally love this movie. And it really included the stuff with the tow truck drivers fighting over the wreckage.
And there's like dead bodies laying there. Yeah.
And it made me also think, like, so many of those films of that era, especially like Down Under and in New Zealand and whatnot, it's like there was like The Cars That Ate Paris.
Right.
And of course, Peter Weir. And then, of course, the Mad Max movies and stuff. A real obsession with like twisted auto wrecks and stuff.
Yeah, I don't know if they were trying to draw some sort of parallel between broken down cars and broken down society or something in a similar way that no gas equals no society in Mad Max.
I'm guessing that they didn't think that far into the symbolism or anything. I think they probably had access to some, you know, rusted out Hulk cars that could make it look like a post-apocalyptic future, and they put that in there. I don't see them trying to draw any parallels there. That's just my interpretation.
But just the stealing, getting rolled for your shoes and the angry dogs, like, immediately thought about my growing up in Surrey.
Oh.
Like,
did the angry dogs try to take your shoes in Surrey?
Well, yeah. Oh. And your feet.
And your feet.
With your feet in them. When, you know, in Surrey, if you went for a jog or just walking home, there'd always be some snarling, drooling monster that would throw itself up against the fence because it's
are we talking about a dog or some of the Surrey
regulars? and a lot of punk rock chicks back in the 80s. So then he goes home.
Yeah. And he hangs with his brother, the big meathead brother.
His big meathead
Meatheed brother.
Yeah, Vegemite.
For the rest of the podcast, I am not going to try to do an Australian. Yeah, please, if I try to just tell me to shut up, if I just try to go there.
Sorry, I can't do it either.
You can do way better than I.
I've met more Australians. So his brother's this big beefcake guy. He wants him to take him to the brother. Take me to the gym, Frank. Frank. He's named after a sausage. That's how much meat is going on in this guy's body. And he's shoveling. They're having dinner, and he's shoveling spaghetti into his face. I don't know if you noticed that, but he's just working down the spaghetti.
He wants to gain weight to be big like his brother. This is the Lamal look-alike.
And was it his mom or his dad and she's making fun of him? Why are you so small? Why are you so small, Krabs?
He's drinking milk while eating spaghetti. And he's a grown man.
Yeah, who drinks milk? Grown man drinks milk.
With spaghetti?
You still drink milk?
I drink milk.
Really? Cow's milk?
Not all the time, but yeah, I drink it.
Really? Yeah, we should get rid of the beer during the podcast, fill that wine glass with milk. Always hated milk. Mm. Ever since I was a kid, I always hated that shit.
Loved it.
Yummy. Ugh. Chocolate delicious. Milk, strawberry milk.
Revolting. See, strawberry milk's revolting.
No, it's
chocolate
good.
Milk, I can't drink anymore.
It's healthier than regular milk because it has strawberries in it.
But the strawberries are just a powder. It's actually no strawberries in the powder.
No, it's nonsense.
Nestle's chemical.
I'm not listening to this. You've been lied to. Fake news.
I was raised on Nestle Quick. Explains the ADHD.
Nestle Quick is the balls of powder that would float at the surface of your milk.
You could pop them. You could never fully stir it in.
No, it was weird.
It was a marvel of science.
Yeah,
it was really weird.
Yeah,
it was delicious sprinkled on vanilla ice cream.
Jesus Christ.
So they're sitting there shoveling milk and spaghetti and milky spaghetti into their face, and then for some reason, Krabs wants to get a ride with his brother to the chippy or the Tai Kawai. And I really am going to have to stop with his accent thing.
Yeah, because he's going for more food after eating his dinner.
No, he must have had some other reason. I think he was just hated being at home with his parents.
Right, well, his mom was a terrible person, making fun of him for being small.
He was kind of small, though. Well, I mean, compared to Frank,
he was just a giant pile.
Yeah, if Lou Ferrigno is your older brother.
He was Lamal small, man. That's how small he was. And yeah, it was a total like.
I don't get it.
It was a total like.
This Lamal thing, I'm going to have to close up this episode with
Bill Bixby into Lou Ferrigno.
So, but not only is he beefy, but he has to be beefy, we find out, because the older brother Frank is a tow truck driver, and in this world, that's the serious business.
But why? How come none of the doors open on any of the cars in this movie?
No, it's like the General Lee, isn't it?
Everyone has to climb in through the windows. Mm-hmm. Like, I think every single vehicle, you have to climb in through the windows in this movie.
Unless you're in a cricket bat fight with somebody, in which case you can just open the door and
hit
him
in the nuts or whatever, yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So this is where we see, I guess, how far society has, it hasn't quite crossed over into a, like apocalypse.
Mad Max.
But it's pretty shitty.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of law. Every man for himself. And
woman.
Oh, Sheila.
Sheila. Yeah. Of course she's a Sheila.
They call him a Sheila.
Yeah.
I did love that there's a Cheryl. One of the girls' names is Cheryl. It's like the Gordon of Australian women. Cheryl.
Is that Cheryl?
Cheryl. Like Shirley. Cheryl.
Okay.
I could be wrong about that.
Right.
Our Australian listeners will no doubt.
They'll be writing letters to you. Just address them to Dylan, care of the Black Dog After Dark.
Black Dog, yep. DylanReimer at gmail.com.
Yeah.
Hashtag not all Cheryls. And they come across this horrible car crash, and turns out that they don't even care about the people bleeding on the street.
No, they want to get the cars.
The scrap.
And then the carboys show up to try to scrap the cars, and then they fight off the carboys with
chain and stuff.
Wrenches and stuff.
Oh, doesn't he hit a guy in the nuts really hard with a... Oh, no, that's later in the movie.
I remember one of the guys says to him, stay healthy, pal. It was like a real threat.
I mean, that was an insult.
I guess. Threat and insult.
Oh, I'm drinking milk, eating spaghetti. It's as healthy as you can get. Anyways, so I guess it's like this coveted position to be a tow truck driver. All of this is just, it doesn't really lay the groundwork to anything.
Nothing. It really has nothing to do with what happens.
It's almost like a teaser to raise money. And then when they got the actual money, they're like, okay, we have to make a much slower paced.
Yeah, let's set it all
movie.
In one area.
By the way, I was really pumped for this movie up until this point.
Uh-oh.
And then they went to the drive-in.
Okay, right. So it's like two different movies.
Well, I was saying that the carboys, like they're supposed to be like, oh no, the carboys are here. And like they're like the least threatening gang, maybe since like possibly Grease, the movie Grease. Like,
yeah.
They're so non-threatening.
The get-along gang.
It reminded me of the way they did remind me sort of, yeah, they weren't at all threatening, but they seem to be based even on the kind of stuff you saw in Class of 1984. It was a very stylized new wave thug kind of thing.
Because the whole point of the movie is that you can't escape from this drive-in, and a lot of people don't want to. And
yes.
So they're trying to show how horrible
the outside world is, which isn't...
The outside, but it didn't seem that bad.
No, it was really tame.
That's kind of my point about Surrey, is it just reminded me of growing
it's
up in Wally.
Shitty area
also,
town.
One thing, yeah, because there's even when one character, the lead character, suggests at one point that he wants to leave when he's basically realizes he's trapped in this dead-end drive-in. The owner makes a threat along the lines of, well, you know the punishment for walking home on the highway.
Yeah.
6 months. And it's like, I would, if it got me out of that place,
three
I'd
months.
Do six
it was
or,
three months.
Or even 3 months. So if it would have been scary if it were like, you know what happens if you step out there? It's all landmines and they'll mow you down with a machine gun.
But,
I don't care about
the thing is, when they showed the, when they're in the drive-in and there's like a wide shot, there's like how you can see houses
you
on
could.
The other side of the fence.
Okay, so
you could see houses.
We should probably get them into the drive-in before we continue. So
wasn't someone driving a tiny red car?
Krabs is a delivery driver, and they try and corner him, and they try and steal his car or whatever.
I can't even remember that part, but yeah.
Somehow Krabs convinces Frank, who's a dick, he somehow convinces him to let him borrow his 1950s
beautiful
car.
Yeah.
1956
Chevy.
Chev Bel Air.
Cherry red.
Yeah, it was nice.
Red and white, yeah.
Yeah, convertible, and he takes his fucking gorgeous girlfriend.
There was some graffiti, some interesting graffiti sometimes in this movie. There's one that said, "Drive East, Die Hard." I have no idea what that means.
Let's drive east to
and then
the theater
and then Die Hard.
Go see Die Hard.
Yeah, that's
Die
what
Hard wasn't out yet.
But neither was Rambo 8. Did you notice that?
Was
oh
there
yeah.
A Rambo 8?
So when they're trying to roll him for his shoes, the Flouncy Boys or whatever they're called.
I don't think they're called the Flouncy Boys.
Whatever the
Carboys.
The Carboys.
Which is what you make beer in, but anyway.
Oh really?
Yeah. It's called a Carboy.
Oh yeah, good. That's where carbonation comes from. It's Carboy Nation. That's Australia.
Carboy Nation.
Australia named itself after the bubbles in beer.
Wow.
It's a little known fact.
Very little.
So when he's like, I like your cheese.
You say cheese.
And then one guy's like, fuck off. Krabs is like, fuck off, mate. And then one of the carboys pulls out this enormous ninja throwing star.
Oh, right. It was huge. It was like a saw from a table saw.
And it was like a table saw stuffed down the front of his pants.
Yeah. Yeah, you don't bend over.
That's comfortable, right?
Yeah.
And he hurls it at him, and then it lands in this big poster of Rambo, and it says Rambo 8, Rambo versus Russia, which actually was Rambo 3.
Yes.
So this movie kind of gets it right.
Yeah. Predicting the future.
Predicting the future. Anyway, the future. So he borrows his brother's car, or steals it or whatever, and he takes his hot ass girlfriend. I shouldn't. That's sexist.
It is sexist. She was a lovely, comely lass.
Beautiful, comely. Anyways, and they go to the drive-in. Now nobody knows the deal with this drive-in, but when you drive in to the drive-in, this dude in a fucking cardigan sweater comes out. And there's two different prices that you can pay. You can pay adults $10,
which is pretty steep for 1986 prices, I think.
Yeah, but the Australian economy has always been ahead of the rest of the world in that, like, they make $20 an hour or whatever.
It was
set in the future, an alternate universe.
True. What they should have done, she should have hidden the trunk.
And your trunk.
And then he would just pay by himself.
But then the guy would have known he was a serial masturbator.
So what?
Hey, serial masturbator.
Marked for death at that point.
Well, so yeah, there's two. It's a two-tier system. It's $10, but if you're unemployed, it's $3.
It's only $3.50, and so he's all cocky, and he's like, "I'll have two at the $3.50 price."
Because he's a cheap cunt. That's why.
That's right.
Cheap guy. Sorry.
That's okay. The Australian is seeping in now.
Yeah, that's right.
That was the closest to an Australian accent I've heard you do all night.
I'll try harder next time.
So, and they drive in, and we find out that his girlfriend. It's kind of on the lam.
Yeah, because she's on the lam from her parents. They don't want her to know. She doesn't want them to know where she is, and then so they park, and then he gives
on the dodgy side of the drive-in.
Well, that's a fucking huge drive-in.
It's a pretty big drive-in.
Yeah, they drive for like it seems like I don't know 20 minutes.
It's like half the outback. Yeah,
because they pull into beside a police car, which is at the drive-in for some reason.
Yeah.
And then who wants to sit beside the cops while you're at the drive-in?
Yeah, while you're drinking off furiously.
So,
serial masturbator, Darren Gay.
You've got to find a more quieter spot. And so they do.
To masturbate, yeah.
And they put the hood up because it starts raining.
And they get down to it.
Well, first, he gives her a nice gift.
A beautiful Australian romance.
I was thinking, oh, he's proposing. He's giving her a ring. But no, it's a lighter.
A lighter. And she acts like it's a fucking ring.
She goes, oh, wow.
It's beautiful. He makes fire by magic.
Yeah.
He may as well have given her that fucking tab off of his beer can.
He put it in a little nice little box too.
Oh, I know. It's when I was
maybe
that age.
Maybe it means something in Australia. Giving your betrothed a lighter.
Yeah, it's the eternal flame.
Yeah, well, if you have to keep it on for it to be eternal.
Oh yeah, right.
Burn your
it's
fingers.
A temporary eternal flame. Yeah. And then they start getting it on, and they take off. By the way, I admired that they took off all of their clothes while boning in a car. I've never taken off all my. Usually, you just kind of shuffle your pants down a bit and go to it.
I've taken all my clothes off except for my socks.
In a car?
Yeah.
And why not your socks? Because the floor was too dirty?
Probably. I don't know.
What kind of car?
It was what was that? I think it was a 72 Monte Carlo. My very first car.
That sounds like a big car.
It was a big car.
So there's some space.
There's a little bit of space, yeah. In the back seat, there's a little bit of space.
So you can hang your clothes up while you're banging.
Yeah, you can totally stretch out. But this car is huge. It's like a motorhome or something inside of it.
No, it's
but I love it. So they start making out, and she goes, oh, wait a second. And then she takes her top off. She says, do you like them? She's like jiggling her big...
I just got them a couple months ago.
The craziest sex that I've ever witnessed in a car.
Witnessed?
Were you looking through binoculars?
No, I was not.
Were you peering in?
For any time I see a scene,
you looked
for example,
up and Alex was watching you.
He's like, so, this.
Sorry, man. I just had an image in my head.
Please.
Sorry, continue with your perverted story, Alex.
Do go on, yes. With your creepy story.
Well, as you both know, I'm from Nova Scotia.
Dartmouth.
I've heard.
Dartmouth, Nova Scotia. That's right. And for many years,
Dartmouth.
I was an employee of the Bridge Commission. And I painted the A. Murray McKay Bridge for several summers. Me and a crew were working. By the way, this story isn't a big perv thing.
Get to the sex.
You're just talking about your big suspension bridge.
Me and this crew, we were on this platform.
Get to the sex.
We were parked over.
Turned on.
Dover Seaview Park, the famous landmark park in Nova Scotia.
Sexy stuff.
We're parked over this park.
It's like Barry White lyrics.
A car, a car pulls up. A little hatchback pulls up under the bridge. We're minding our own business eating
perfect
lunch, but we're looking down into the park.
You're having a big footlong.
We were just eating our sandwiches and stuff, and this little hatchback parks directly beneath us. It's like 300 feet below us. You check it out.
That's a coincidence, isn't it?
Yeah, they park underneath, and it's a skinny little white dude and an extremely large woman. But this car parks in the nook, and they look around, and you see literally 300 feet directly below our platform. We're looking feet? Down. Yeah.
How could you even see that? So we're looking down. Away.
No, it's trust me, it's easier.
Binoculars,
than,
right?
It's easier. No binoculars. It's right there, man. Tell us you so. Know what's going on. You can deduce it.
It's like watching ants hump.
The two of them are checking out, scouting, making sure no cars are coming by, nothing. Then all you see is the woman's legs open.
Presumably.
You see these two huge knees. Then you see a skinny little white man's butt. Plop in between those knees.
Plop. So erotic.
Going at it so hard. I'm not joking. His ass cheeks are hitting the inside of the windshield.
Wow.
Really?
As he's going at it with her. It looked like someone was spanking him with plexiglass. It was crazy, man. But that was the craziest. And then so they jumped apart. A car came along. They really went at it for a while. Hard for like a minute and a half. And then this other car comes along. And they suddenly jump apart. And they're like, oh. Kind of like calm down. And then the car drives by. And then as soon as the car passes, they start going at it again.
Wow.
A friend I told this to was one of the many friends I told this to later.
I'm sure.
I was like, you know, and by the way, we saw no faces, no license plate. Not that we would ever reveal that information, but we weren't out creeping around, perving on people. We were eating our lunch. A car pulls up in front of you and does that.
I'm
what else are you going to do? Of course we watched.
Glad you wouldn't have sold them
out. Of course we watched.
I'm really hoping you didn't, like, drip mayonnaise from your sandwich onto their windshield. I hope that's mayonnaise.
Okay. Yeah, they're looking every which way, but they don't think to look up.
Well, who would?
300 feet above you. Just look up, goddammit. If you're going at it in a car, look up.
Yeah, the moral of that story is...
And we learn what happens, too. These two, as well, haphazardly having sex in a car, you know, an inappropriate moment in a wide-open setting, just like the people in the park that...
But it was,
here's the parallel. Yeah. They're doing it in the movie, and it gets them in trouble, does it not?
Yes, of course.
Yes, it does. And how do they get into trouble? Let's move on here.
The tires get stolen. So, by the way, like, you must be boning pretty hard if you don't notice people removing two of your wheels.
Two of them, yeah.
Or that there's people 300 feet above you watching you while eating sandwiches.
Satellite of love. That's you, Alex.
Oh. And she doesn't really care. She just, and at this point, she wants to watch the movie. And she acts like she's never seen a movie before. I've got to see how this ends. And some shit. I don't know what movie it was.
Well, one of these movies, at least one of the ones that they watch, it's called The Man from Hong Kong. It's also made by this
movie. I was actually curious about the movies because they were more interesting to watch than the movie I was actually watching.
All of the movies in this movie are
Brian Trenchant Smith
right. films. And in one case, Turkey Shoot. It got an R rating in Australia, and so he had to remove footage so that he got down to like a, I don't know, mature or whatever.
Turkeys got shot?
Too many, that's right. But he took the footage that they had to cut out and put it into this movie.
Oh, really?
So he took all of the super violent shit he couldn't show in Turkey Shoot, and then he had everyone be watching it in Dead End Drive-In.
There's one scene in one of the movies that was on screen of this guy hang gliding through New York City. I was like, what fucking movie is that? I want to watch this movie.
I'd actually kind of like to watch this guy's filmography, because it's all over the fucking map. Where were we? Okay, so, he's butt naked, he's running around in his boots.
He's looking for his tires,
because
someone just stole two tires off of his car. Some people just stole two tires off his car.
Yeah.
And he sees the cops wheeling them, put them into the back of a cop van.
Yeah.
And so what can you do?
Yeah. And so he goes to the main office.
he's told... He has to spend the night at the drive-in.
Yeah, like, you're screwed, mate.
you can't go anywhere. At this point, because I still didn't know what this movie was about, I'm like, he's got to spend the night at the drive-in? What the fuck is going on here? When does the horror movie start? I'm still waiting, thinking it's a horror movie.
At this point, I realized, okay, this is no horror movie. It's definitely just Mad Max, high-octane rip-off. It seemed at the beginning, but it became a very low-octane.
A very low-octane.
Yeah.
Like, no octane.
The movie, yeah, for me... kind of stopped at this point on. You know what I mean? I hate to just jump on the movie. First of all...
No, fair enough.
Like, there are definitely really great elements in this movie and stuff like that, but really, aside from a strong opening, the rest... And I love the concept of a drive-in theater. It's like as an internment camp.
It's like a mini Escape from New York.
You think about it, there would be... Yeah, but for me, yeah, I just found this movie to be a collection of really annoying characters... and unrealized concepts. Mm-hmm.
I'll give you that. There's a lot of unrealized potential here.
The visual look of this movie, by the way, is incredible.
Well, no, I mean, it does look great. Like they all the money, what little money they have, went into making this drive-in look cool with the cars. And the thing is,
it's
easy and it's cheap. You get some paint, some spray paint, and you just make it look really interesting.
They used a condemned drive-in theater. No. That they were going to knock down. But the projector still worked. Anyway, so he's told, you're screwed. You're screwed, mate, for tonight. Just hop on back to your car. You can't.
There's no taxis. There's no buses. You can't walk.
Oh, yeah. And it's
the walk. But if you try to walk out, the punishment's so minuscule.
It's 3
months. That's one thing that killed the movie for me is right here. From here, it should have been like, oh, I only get 3 months. Fuck it, I'm walking back. You walk back, and then somehow maybe you get dragged back.
But the thing is,
it's so lame.
But then you can see some houses and stuff on the other side of the fence. So you just walk to the houses, and ask, use the phone, call a cab.
Yeah, or presumably like those houses are now abandoned. But yeah,
I was assuming they were abandoned.
Well, that's
I didn't assume they were abandoned.
I didn't assume either because the
completely flat at this point.
Also, at this point, I mean, what am I supposed to do? Is it, well, you can't walk up the highway. You know, well, now it's 3 months in prison. Well, why did you tell me a bunch of history about how society got to this point at the beginning? Why didn't you establish the martial law rules that were in place? Maybe in that pointless conversation where they're shoveling spaghetti into their face over dinner. You know, maybe the dad's watching the news like, the bloody liberals. It needs to be harder on these people walking around on the highways.
Vice.
You know?
Is that the major problem in the future, is just people walking on the highway?
Well, because some of them are the Incredible Hulk.
Aside from a very minimal police presence in this place, and it's so minimal, it's like it's Mr. Rogers as the warden. Like, what the fuck? Yeah. Knock the guy out and leave. Like, it's just the least threatening. Like, the movie's just amok. And it's like, I kind of felt like I was watching it reminded me a lot of Burning Man at this point. It was like, you're trapped in Burning Man. Just leave.
I have Burning Man written in my notes.
Yeah, it was funny.
Actually, it's funny. When I was watching this at this point, when I realized that they have to live at the fucking drive-in. when my kid came home, and he asked what I'm watching. And he said, I'm watching this weird movie where people are forced to live at the drive-in. And he goes, you mean a drive-thru, right?
Drive-thru.
Because he's 12. He's never been to a drive-in.
As they wind up living there longer, you realize a lot of these characters have been there for like a good amount of time, right? And then you also realize that, okay, well, we're just going to shuffle out. Like, any deadbeat who would go to the drive-in deserves to live at the drive-in.
Yeah, exactly.
It's kind of the government's.
So everybody that went there and said unemployed has to live at the drive-in.
Well, that's what you get for fucking lying, man. You should have paid the extra $7.
Yeah.
Whatever. So they go back, they sleep in the car, and then they...
His biggest concern is getting caught by his brother. And then there's the next scene, people spray painted shit all over his car.
And by the end of it, he abandons the fucking car, and he steals a fucking cop van, which apparently there's no punishment for that.
And then he meets that weird, you know, new age gang with the most annoying fucking people in it. Ugh. Like that really tall guy with the he can't act worth a shit. He has the worst laugh. And then they introduce the guy who can't speak because he stutters too much.
Yeah, yeah.
That's Dylan.
Oh my god, really? I didn't even notice that. Yeah. Of course he's called Dylan.
It's Dylan?
Fuck, I have to change my name. And there's like the one guy standing behind him who isn't scary at all.
No, none of them are scary. None of them are threatening in any way whatsoever.
The leader, like, I just kept thinking of like a grown-up Australian version of our gang.
Would he be Spanky, I guess?
Yeah, like with the hair and all that. Like they all have... When you went to Burger King in the 80s, on the placemats, they'd always have these, like, this gang of different characters. And one was into the computer guy. One guy was in a wheelchair. And then there was the girl. And then, you know what I mean? And, like, these guys just seem like washed up adult versions of this, like...
Kind of, like, 80s, new wave-ish Bowery Boys. But for me, I thought it was like Ducky Gets a Gang.
Yeah,
that's
perfect.
What it's like, and it's like,
who's Ducky?
Well, where's John Cryer? And you know,
well, Ducky,
were the wimpiest gangs. Oh, they were. They really
and
were.
For whatever reason, they're hanging in the bathroom. Who was hanging in the fucking bathroom?
Well,
the girls
are hanging in the bathroom. Everyone's hanging in the bathroom.
The girls' bathroom is just—it's full.
Well,
it's full of girls. And
I do remember going to malls as a kid, and there was always some people hanging out in those damn.
But
bathrooms.
Not everyone.
And I don't just mean the old pervs.
Again,
you mean the people who are hanging out on the bridge? Another, they retire to the bathroom and discuss what they saw on the bridge.
There's another nice little graffiti bit in the girls' bathroom. Said, Jill does blowjobs. It's not even the proper grammar.
.com.
Hey, class of 1984, lots of bathroom action.
But at least those guys were threatening. Like, those guys were. They were a threatening gang.
Yeah, they were scary.
You felt the menace. Here, there's no menace.
No, yeah, they were just like, they were soft as rotten fruit, man.
They were soft as Dennis the Menace.
And then they showed dude, I guess he's running, he's going for a jog.
Yeah.
But he's carrying two bricks.
Oh, yeah.
he's kind of prancing. He's prancing with bricks around the drive-in. And at this point, I'm like, what the fuck is going on?
It's like 80s aerobics video.
Okay, so the whole time, there's this scene when he basically tries to talk his way out of the drive-in. Thompson, who's the old guy, who, by the way, has the most acting credentials.
He was the only guy that could act in the whole movie.
By the way, you want to have some fun? Nope. Go to IMDb and just look up Dead End Drive-In and then just start checking out all the weird Australian television and shit that these people are on. He was the star of something called Computer Ghosts, which the poster...
I would watch that in a heartbeat.
I would watch Computer Ghosts.
Why don't we watch Computer Ghosts instead of this movie? Computer goats or ghosts?
Computer goats.
See, I would definitely watch Computer Goats.
Ghosts eat dotes and goats eat dotes. Well, little lambs eat ivy.
So they're living in the car now. And I'm actually like, that car looks okay to live in. It's pretty spacious. You know,
yeah, they're stretched out.
They're just, you know, hanging out, having sex. And she's at the point where she's cool living at the driveway.
Well, because she's been
For the rest of her life.
Yeah, she's been on the run from her fucking crazy mom.
She's found friends who did her hair for her.
So Thompson, who is the Mr. Rogers guy, has this questionnaire and it's like, you know, and they, I guess both of them don't want their families knowing where they are, so neither of them say, oh yes, please phone my brother, my psycho meathead brother Frank, and tell him that I took his car to bone my girlfriend at the drive-in. Even though Frank would have gotten his fucking,
he would have like barreled right in there. Because did you see that pickup truck? It had like roll bars on the outside of it going right across the windshield. Yeah. It was crazy. It was built for Mad Max.
And I was expecting that brother to come back at some point.
I was hoping he would.
Like,
yeah.
I think such a waste.
Like, this movie for me was just a lot of, like, a really promising opening and just wasted ideas.
Yeah. I'll give you wasted ideas, but I don't think, in execution, I still found it really great to look at.
It was
cinematography in this thing
it was a nice restoration. It was widescreen, so like imagine the original VHS that we all you saw,
the one I have, yeah,
looked like shit, but they did a nice job restoring it and it looked good, but that only goes so far, you know, like that.
I was genuinely bored watching this.
This one scene when he's talking to the girlfriend in the car. And he's trying to explain why he wants to leave. And she's all upset. She thinks she's the problem. You know, that the reason he wants to leave is because of her. But no, it's because they have to force live in a fucking drive-in. To me, that's just so dumb. I don't like.
For me, I think there was that attempt to make it like certain people, including maybe the girlfriend, but the people who are also there, the guys and gals who are already camp already.
They're
really easy to placate through trashy pleasure and like fast food
ridiculous. They're all the same age.
Yeah.
They're all like early 20s. Yeah. Everybody that's there.
Yeah. Like, I mean, that was the point of the movie.
I guess.
No, it was.
It was a punk
well,
Bernie
I
man.
Recognize that, but it was just still dull.
Oh, yeah,
like,
no, I'm not saying.
It's like, let's trap people in the food court. Who cares?
I don't think this. It's weird. What I appreciate about this movie is, I liked looking at it. Mm-hmm. I liked the costumes. I loved all of the extras. It's not often that I actually spend time watching extras.
Well, because they were way more interesting than the leads. You know, when they showed scenes of all the extras, because they looked like punk rocking guys.
And just like
punk rocking guys. You know,
punk rocking guys.
They all get their change of clothes from.
They don't.
Stuff. They all had fresh wardrobes.
Well, there was a
the
scene
time
when they had some clothes strung up between cars. I guess they washed them somehow.
Yeah, but how many pairs of clothes do you take to a dryer?
The story did very little for me.
Yes.
But I think it made up for it in atmosphere.
I have a question. There's a scene when there's like a whole bunch of montage things going on. There's a guy with a monkey.
I don't remember the guy.
There's a monkey, and everyone's laughing. Having fun with the monkey.
Oh yeah, like, you're right. The monkey.
Who brings a fucking monkey to the drive-in?
You perverts.
I guess. What are you gonna do? It wasn't a big monkey.
Who dangles over a bridge and watches interracial couples have sex?
With like an extended telescope. One of those.
Yeah. then drools on the top of their car.
Yeah, with a. Mayonnaise. I'm doing air quotes. Mayonnaise.
Yeah. A real sick weirdo too. I mean, you abused your privileges as a bridge painter. Okay, so yes, I appear to be the defender of this film because I don't really care about any of that stuff. Well, I thought it was a really colorful, interesting, vibrant.
I just wish there was something. I just wish there was something more interesting going on, which brings us to me, though. Which the best and maybe the only really good scene in the movie, and that's the cricket bat fight.
Oh, I love the cricket bat fight.
Yeah, because I really hate that fucking guy that he fought, that really tall guy who has the worst. He can't act worth a shit, but you know he's a big guy and he had to fight, and it was. I thought it was pretty good.
But the fight scene was really poorly directed.
It was the best scene in the movie.
I liked it.
it's an ordinary.
Anyway, American. So he's jogging and but he's in the wrong in that one. He runs right through their cricket game.
Yeah.
I would have hit him with a fucking bat too.
Yeah.
Anyways, they get in this fight and he winds up like. I thought it was actually a pretty well orchestrated fight scene because it's on top of cars and in cars and he crawls at one. So that when he's being attacked by one of the get along gang.
The big guy with the terrible haircut who every time he opened his mouth, it was just like fingers on a chalkboard to me. He's like, oh, my God.
Yeah, his character name probably was Fingers because they all had these, like, nicknames. He winds up hitting the guy really hard with like, a chunk of rock.
Mm-hmm.
And then the guy is, like, two scenes later.
He's fine.
Even though he was, like, twitching on the ground.
Yeah, and then there's no real ill will between them.
This movie has problems. I would have liked there to have been scarier bad guys, more tension, and more obstacles in the way of him escaping the dead-end drive-in.
Mm.
But I still enjoyed the movie.
It's funny. When they're having the fight, the guy says to him, if you were a man, you'd do something about it. But he doesn't say what it is. She didn't allude to what it was.
She's talking about the racism. She's like, you know.
No, she's all for the racism.
Later in the movie, she definitely says that exact line when he's like, are you out of your mind? Are you out of your mind? Have you gone bleeping bleepers? Have you gone gugglier than a buckle chuck grew?
I don't know what you just said there, but it was funny.
I just made it up. Carmen's character in two different scenes says the exact same line to two different characters. Huh. And that line is, what are you, me mother? Because when they first go into the diner,
right. Yep.
She's like, I hate eggs. I hate eggs. And I was like, I hate eggs.
Really? I love eggs.
Fucking disgusting.
Them every day.
Well, Alex knows. I had an egg sandwich. I choked it down. But anyways.
You gave a description of eggs one day at the shop that was so vile. I couldn't eat eggs for a couple of weeks.
Are you kidding?
I'm not kidding.
What did I say?
Well, you said, among other things, how, like, these factories feed chickens their own spinal columns and stuff.
Oh, yeah. Well, they do.
Every time.
Eat those goddamn eggs. Get those, the organic, the free-range eggs.
Well, there's that. But even then, it's still disgusting.
But no, they're delicious.
They're not that great.
Oh.
Anyways, because Carmen actually says the line, what do you mean, Martha? Like, to two different characters in two different scenes.
And it tries to be a catchy line. Oh, it's excruciating. That's all. Like, that's all I can say. This movie, I found it excruciatingly annoying and boring.
Well, okay. I don't think we're there yet, but I think I know what you're...
Oh, I'm there yet.
I thought
they should have dropped the drive-in part and left dead end.
I don't think it's quite as superficial and shallow as you guys.
It's not superficial and shallow. It just doesn't work.
Well, there are moments that I did enjoy in it. There's a scene in there. They're eating in the cafeteria or whatever, and someone mentions that they got a gut full of poisonous hamburger, and my wife walked into the room just as that line went on, and she goes, well, isn't everything poisonous in Australia? And then she said, you're not going to tell anyone that I said that line, are you? I'm giving props to my wife.
We should have had her on the show tonight. She could have told that story. And then went home? I'm not saying it's superficial and shallow. It just didn't come together and none of it worked. Like, they throw in this really preachy scene with anti-immigration ideas. And of course that's valid. Of course that's something worth criticizing and being with Trump now in office and all this shit. It's a timeless issue, immigration.
Especially in Australia.
It's a couple of sloppy lines just thrown into
the...
And it really went nowhere.
It was so ham-fisted with the way they tried to show him as being... not that way. When the Indian dude comes into the bathroom with his the turban that it's being racist to show that he's not racist. He puts his arm around him while he's peeing, and they pulls him away from his urination, and it's like, you're okay, man.
From me, I'm pitching.
Yeah, it was so terrible.
See, there I was defending him, and I was racist by doing that action.
Exactly.
There was all this mishmash. Like, all the elements were there for
something.
An incredible movie, but I just thought it just
I have written down here, sticks up for the stereotype in the bathroom.
Well, at least someone's sticking up for the stereotype.
Yep. And so there's a big rally for all the white people.
We should establish something first.
Okay, sure.
Up until this point, it's entirely white Australians.
Yes.
And then for whatever reason...
Actually,
I want to talk about this. Mm-hmm. It's overwhelmingly white Australians.
98%.
And they ship in a bunch of, I guess, like Chinese, Korean, Vietnamese.
They're Asians that are shipping into the...
Just out of the blue, the government's like, we need someone to put these immigrants. And they just dump them there.
That's it. They don't show them at all anymore in the movie.
Oh, yeah, you never see them.
No, they show them coming in and that's it. They didn't even register me that...
I guess in some ways, though, the reason why no one seems menacing in this movie, when you really think about it, it's like, it's not like gangsters and bikers are always like, go to the drive-in. It's like the people who are going to go there and get trapped are basically unemployed geeks.
Yeah.
So you're really just like a bunch of film critics and stuff trying to, but still, because there's even when fighting breaks,
way
someone's seen the movie. Because they're having this whole, I know it's like Harry Knowles. Actually, Harry Knowles on the loose in the drive-in. Actually, that's pretty terrifying.
That's a remake I want.
Scary holes of Harry Knowles. Film critics and bloggers log together. The equivalent would be, they're such dollars.
Dullard?
The total shift here was, I came out of nowhere. They're all like against the Asians that have come in.
Yeah.
And they had this big rally in the cafeteria or whatever. Yeah. But then there's a black dude sitting there.
Dude, that, which made me laugh, because I think even the actor was having a hard time with this scene where he's like, "What? Why am I up front? Is it because I'm black?"
So they're only racist against Asians?
I made a note of that.
I haven't read it. They're only racist.
Black guy in the group looks confused. Should I be here? Yeah. And all of a sudden, Johnny Pompadour, the guy with the flaccid Pompadour.
Well, the leader of the shitty gang.
He gets up. He calls them rice gobblers. I mean, I don't know if this is an actual racist term. But
it sounds racist.
Bunch of bloody rice gobblers.
I like rice.
But I'm like,
I don't gobble it.
Australian get off criticizing anyone else's food. The racism plot goes nowhere. Before they dropped all of these Asian people off in the dead end drive-in, they dropped off a bunch of cars for no reason.
Yeah, but a bunch of cars that didn't work, but they had parts on them that could work.
Well, why? Okay, if you are this government and you're like, great, I got the Harry Knowleses and the red letter media, I got them trapped. I got trapped in that drive-in.
And I get it by removing car parts. I think I'll ship in lots of cars with more car parts.
Yeah.
Especially after the manager's telling you there's nowhere you can
get
car parts.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
In the middle of the largest desert on the planet.
Yes.
No, put it inside those walls, not anywhere
not
outside.
Anywhere else.
Another thing that drove me nuts is Krabs, his girlfriend's like, why don't we just get out and walk? And he says, and drive Frank's car back without Ford wheels? He'll kill me.
It's still his main concern is how his giant meathead brother's going to react to his car being trashed.
Hey, dipshit, take any wheels, doesn't put them
matter.
On the car, and then drive to the wheel store in downtown fucking Adelaide and buy a couple of Ford wheels.
So weak.
I'm still thinking it's a horror movie at this point. I'm waiting for the horror.
Still waiting, because the old
the
man
slasher
is...
slasher to come out.
Yeah, the old man's going to dress up as Crocodile Dundee and start chopping people up with a knife.
Yeah, that's not a knife.
That's not... This is a knife.
Krabs gets on the future computer, which is really old looking. Terrible.
Dude.
I think it's a Commodore 64 or something like that.
Because Mr. Rogers, goes for one of his 71 daily peas.
Yeah, and then there's a shootout. He gets a hold of a gun. He shoots a couple cops. He shoots the Mr. Rogers.
Is this after he steals the gas? Oh, no, he runs out of gas because he's been fucking running his engine the whole time with no wheels.
Yeah, he's running his engine. He's like checking the engine to make sure it's fine.
We've got to keep the engine running. Otherwise, Frank will kill me.
But yeah, he steals gas out of the cop car.
Which I thought was a pretty good scene.
It was okay. Yeah, it siphons it. But
I always like it when people siphon gas in the movies.
Have you ever siphoned gas?
No.
Because you end up with a mouthful of gasoline when you siphon gas. And he just spits it out casually. And I was like, you're gonna fucking barf. Like, yeah. It's awful.
The best scene of siphoning gas in a movie is Cheech and Chong's Things Are Tough All Over. That's the only memorable scene in the movie.
I don't remember that movie.
A bunch of stuff happens, and then they're all having their big racism meeting. So Krabs, he takes the wheels. Does he ever bother putting them back on the car?
He puts them back on Frank's car.
Yeah, and then he's out of gas.
And he's out of gas, so he steals gas, he puts the gas in the car, he has a shootout with the cops, so he blows some of them up, they're just chasing around the drive, they're driving slowly around the drive-in, shooting each other. For some reason, there's a giant ramp that if you had a car and had enough velocity, you could jump over the electrified wall and get out of the drive-in.
I thought the ramp was like a knocked-over piece of that truck that brought all the cars and all the
Asians. It was a perfect ramp to leap out of the drive-in in a car.
Coincidentally.
And to go through the sign that said Star Drive-In or whatever.
By the way, that was one of the most expensive stunts ever completed at that time.
It was the world record. In fact, I wrote the guy's name down.
Most expensive stunts?
Guy Norris.
One of them.
Like driving a car through a neon sign over a fence?
Guy Norris, the stunt coordinator who did the whole thing, including driving, doing the jump. And I thought it was a pretty impressive stunt, personally.
It was the
point where it smashes. Okay, so it goes up the ramp.
It's Mad Max, that's for sure.
Except he also did Mad Max.
Which is head and shoulders above anything.
I didn't think it was as filmed as well as it could have been. It should have been like a wider shot from like a crane or a tower or something off in the distance to capture him crashing that sign. Like, to me, it just looked like.
You guys are
He took about a two foot jump.
And when he lands, he actually says, beauty.
You know what? Well, there's a lackluster. Another example of that is there's an infamous stunt in a Burt Reynolds movie called. He did a serious cop film. No, in the early.
Peter?
You're on the right track. Sharky's Machine.
Sharky's Machine.
I like with Rachel Ward. Ward, yeah.
Watch it again. It's so dated. There's this famous stunt at the end where a guy jumps out the window of a tower, but it's totally wasted within the movie. Right. It was like a guy did a.
It was a huge tower drop.
He's a very famous Dar Robinson, I believe was his name. Legend of the stunt world.
Yeah. Legend of the stunt world.
That's incredible. Focused an episode on him pulling off the stunt.
Because he fell, that's what I felt this like reminded me of.
That's incredible. It was a television series in the early 1980s.
And Dylan was a co-host.
So anyways.
I would just like to give stuntman Guy Norris his due credit.
Okay. Is he still alive?
I have no idea.
Does he listen to this podcast?
I hope so.
Maybe from the grave.
I hope everybody.
From the other side.
Hey, I'm haunting you, boo. Okay, so yeah, he worked on Mad Max and Road Warrior. Most recently, Fury Road, I'm assuming he's still alive.
Right.
And at the time, this had the world record, 163-foot jump. I like the way it was filmed.
I have to agree with Alex. I think that they showed it from different angles, and instead of like inside the car, not very impressive. Because it's just up and down, and you smash it into the ground. Like,
what? No, it's not.
No, it's not.
They show him going through the fucking sign.
Yeah, but
and
it
then
is,
they, and then they.
But
they,
there's no context for the scale of how high it is or how big it is. It's just them going. He's just driving through a sign. It's like a close up.
I got a pretty good impression of it. Especially when it was landing, because it came down. It was slightly in slow mo, and you actually felt the impact of the weight.
The car went through the sign. I thought of the car crashing through the wall in Gino Vannelli's Black Cars video.
Oh, my God.
And then when I read on the internet after watching the movie, all the effort that went into that, I just thought, God damn it, you pulled a Sharky's machine. You invested all this into a stunt.
That's a noun?
And it's like the guy jumps out the window in Sharky's machine. It looks like a dummy.
Anyways, we're at the end of the movie.
Okay, so yeah.
And he's just driving off and he goes, beauty!
Beauty. And then the 80s music kicks in and that's that.
And I was waiting for something more. I thought maybe he was going to meet up with his brother.
I thought so too, but that's not the point.
No.
So maybe I'm thinking the movie is deeper than it is.
The movie's not deep whatsoever.
Because the whole point was about him escaping, and everybody else is complacent. And then I started thinking about how I read a statistic somewhere that something like, for real, 90% of Australian...
Live at a drive-in?
Everything is the suburbs in Australia. And I think this is sort of a commentary on pop culture. And
yeah, maybe. I don't know.
And I was thinking, like, the idea of being afraid of growing older and settling down is kind of how I was reading it. Because it's represented through the car, because the car, like, he gradually just...
It got deteriorating.
It was deteriorating. I don't know. I saw something there. Did you guys pick up on any of this?
No, no. I was bored by like, I was happy when it ended.
To me, it was like, okay, look, a smoothie can taste really good, right?
I love a good smoothie.
Hell yeah, but if it's just sitting there in the blender all lumped together, that's what it was.
It wasn't blended properly.
It was lumped together ideas, the setting, the characters, none of it. It was just all lumped together. There were great ideas everywhere. And the look of the movie is amazing, but in the stunts and stuff, but it was all lumped together in a really boring,
annoying film. I'm focused on those ideas and the way it looks, and that's enough for me. But I completely agree. The story could have been a hell of a lot better told. There could have been more characters. Well, there could have been some characters.
Or it's not even that. The characters, they could have just had them, like, talk less and fight or something. Yell out those ideas and then fight something, anything. But it was so dull. Mm-hmm. That was, for me, was the... the big flaw of this movie. And by the way, I'm not one of those guys. I'll never tell someone not to enjoy a movie.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know what? I seldom don't even not recommend a film. Watch what you want. Get what you want out of it. I don't want to give some big copy wimp out answer here. But I'm just saying, though. But if you flat out asked me, like, there's a lot of likable qualities in this movie. But if you flat out asked me what I thought of it, I was bored and annoyed completely.
I was never bored. And I was never annoyed.
I wasn't bored in the opening.
I thought elements were ridiculous. And I thought, like, it wasn't the most...
Are we doing final thoughts?
Flushed out?
Yeah.
I guess we've just sort of I know what
your final thoughts are.
Naturally eased up into it. It's far from perfect compared to other Ozploitation films that I've seen. Or it could have just been cheap and trashy, and I actually thought it had, at least it was trying to say something.
I guess. I know. I thought it was kind of cheap and trashy, but you know, I'm going to give it like a very slight recommendation.
Mm-hmm.
Thought it could have been way better.
You know what I would recommend this with?
Forest Gump.
Streets of Fire.
Yes!
Yeah,
a movie that's nighttime
call.
And looks great.
I agree.
It has amazing ideas, but doesn't quite mesh.
Exactly.
Kayla Janice will, like, personally assassinate me for saying that. But
dude,
I don't love Streets of Fire. I really enjoy Streets of Fire. I feel it's a really unfulfilled kind of movie, as pretentious as that sounds.
I feel the exact same way about Streets of Fire
as you do. Streets of Fire.
I think it looks great, and, you know, it's interesting, but it just doesn't really, there's not much there.
Well, you guys in your substance.
I like a little bit more than just a good-looking film.
Not me.
Not me. Well, it's funny, when I was watching it, and I pair this with The Road Warrior, but that's so fucking obvious.
Yeah, well,
so I'm gonna pair it with The Road Warrior.
Really?
Because
not Mad Max?
Well, because I don't really like Mad Max. I've only seen the dub version of Mad Max on VHS. I've never seen the proper. The Road Warrior is one of my top three films of all time. It's trying to operate in the same universe, post-apocalyptic Australia. And it's such a great movie to watch this and then watch something involving cars in the future. And yeah, I would pair with that. And watch The Road Warrior second, because then you'll see what a good film in post-apocalyptic future looks like, instead of watching, Dead End Driving.
You guys get pissing all over my pick.
No, the thing is, we're not going to like the same thing all the time, and Dead End Driving is not a very good film.
It's at least good. Come on.
No, it's not very good. It's not terrible, but it's not very good.
Well, and within the world of Black Dog, and I don't mean this as like cynical, just wanting to do business. Seriously, like, I know customers I'd recommend this to. There's a lot to really be into this movie, and I could see this totally being a favorite of so many people, but for me,
Well, I just have to clarify.
I guess I'm saying it again.
Right now,
I guess
Alex,
I just said that
right now,
60
Alex
times,
is drinking beer out of an enormous wine glass, and his hand is rested on his hip. He's wearing a scarf, and all I can think of is Truman Capote.
You would do well at the Dead End Drive-In. Film critic, you get the scarf.
That's the thing, too. For me, this just wouldn't be a bad thing. I'd love it.
It's a movie every night. In your car?
I love it. By the way, Night of the Demons is the one where they're trapped in the movie theater, correct?
Not Night of the Demons.
No,
is
Demons.
That Demons?
Demons.
Okay, Demons. And
Dario
that's not
Argento,
the same director?
Man.
No, it's not Dario Argento.
He produced
Fulci,
it.
It slips my mind who did it.
I think it's Fulci, is it? Or it's one of those guys in that, the Italian.
But
era.
That would make a great pairing, too, even though that film's way better.
Argento
but I love
produced
Trapped in the
Actually, that's a good call.
That is a good call.
But still, way better than this one.
So my double bill is Demons and the Road Warrior.
Okay.
Don't watch Dead End Driving. Watch Demons and the Road Warrior.
So I'll double down on Dead End Driving. I really like this movie. So it's my turn. Yeah, the pairing is obvious. Computer Ghosts.
or Goats.
If you can get a copy of Computer Ghosts. But I'm going to recommend George Romero's Knight Riders, starring Ed Harris.
An old Romero movie. I don't think I've ever seen this one.
It's a very strange movie about people who reenact King Arthur's court on motorcycles. And it's like, it's similarly high concept.
How come they don't make movies like this anymore?
They do, but we just never hear about them.
Well, no, like 80s, the 70s, 80s, and early 90s, they just made crazy movies like that. They don't do this anymore. It's all the same shit, like Marvel and Disney. And
it's all too predictable. All boring.
I'm not BSing you. I thought of Knight Riders while watching this film.
Bullshit.
You are so full of the shit of balls.
Both films for me, yeah, amazing concepts that didn't quite break through.
Mm-hmm. And if you can find it, I'll add a caveat. No, because this movie is next to impossible to find, and it's amazing. It's called Psychomania.
Oh, well, we used to have that.
It's about
it's Australian too, right?
No, that's British.
I mean, it's British, right?
It's about it's a motorcycle gang in swinging 60s England who discover the secret to eternal life is just to really believe that you're not going to die when you kill yourself. And so,
that's a leap of faith.
But Knight Riders. I'm going to go with Knight Riders with Ed Harris, directed by George Romero.
Cool.
I'm saying I would recommend this. I will recommend it. And I'm very, very happy that since we attained Dead End Drive-In, we've actually had like a handful of customers quite excited.
They're
thrilled.
There's definitely an audience for this film. Generally, I like this genre of film. I like crazy 80s things like Society, which I just watched a little while ago, which I really like to do this podcast because I really like to talk about the movie.
You can force me to watch it, sure.
Because it's amazing.
We are located in beautiful, sunny Vancouver, British Columbia.
You mean foggy, rainy, decrepit.
It sucks everywhere this time of year.
Beautiful city. I like living here.
1470 Commercial Drive and
3451 Canby Street.
Across from the Park Theater.
Yeah.
Come by and visit us.
And we'll recommend a movie to go with Dead End Drive-In.
Dead End Drive-In.
Yeah. Dead End Driving.
I will recommend it.
Dylan will recommend Dead End Driving.
All I'm going to say about Dead End Driving is drive in, but it's a dead end.
All right.
Yeah, I'll end on that. That's good enough.
All right. Well, good night, everyone.
Yeah.
Good day. Good day, right.
Good night, mate.
Good day, mate.
That's what they say when they go to bed. That's how they backwards they are in Australia.
Because they go to bed in the daytime and sleep and be awake at night, right?
Yeah. Jeez.